Welcome to the macro photography video. We're going to start out by looking at the PowerPoint lecture, and I'm going to put a voiceover narration on that. And then we're going to come back and I'll just do a little quick shooting to get you started on the basic techniques. We're going to talk about a lot of things on macro photography, but let's just begin by talking about what macro photography is in the scientific sense. Macro photography is photo macroscopy, and that describes photographing small but visible objects. So for general purposes, anytime the size of the subject achieves a greater magnification than 1:1, but does not exceed what the naked eye can see, the result is considered to be a photo macrograph, and we just call that a macro photograph. Now, this is different than photomicroscopy, which is microphotography, which means taking photos of items that are too small to be seen with the naked eye. And this type of photography is usually done with a microscope or other device. I want to begin this lecture by talking about a piece of equipment that I think you'll have so much fun with in doing micro photography. This is a inexpensive USB microscope, and it's available for less than $25. And it's not as convenient as a handheld camera because you have to plug it into a computer using the USB connection, but it works really, really well, and it has a built-in light. So the one that I'm showing here is available on Amazon for both PC computers and Macs. If you want to have a lot of fun, especially with kids in a science project, you can't get better than this. It's so much fun. Here's a little shot that I did of seaweed floating in red food coloring, taken with a microscope accessory. So it's really fun for kids. Now let's look at what some other serious photographers use when they do macro photography. There's obsessive people. This is one of my setups, actually. Our macro approach is going to be much simpler. Normally, a camera with a big sensor is preferred for the best quality in general purpose photography, but a small sensor camera is actually better for some close-up work and also some lightweight macro work. Here I am taking a photograph of some coins, and it's in a museum that they wouldn't let me take my camera in. This example shows that a modern cell phone can be as sharp as a $2,500 Nikon lens for most general close-ups. The cell phone is an older Samsung Note 5. It's on the left. And then we see the Nikon with a close-up filter, which we're going to talk about, and it's on the right. So there's really not much difference at all at that magnification. A lot of pocket cameras have a close-up feature, and although the close-up mode on most cameras allows for close views, it doesn't achieve a true macro magnification. But you can always zoom in to the image and make it look like it was taken with a macro lens. So these were done with a really small pocket camera, a Lumix. Another approach, and this is kind of a very traditional approach, is using extension tubes. And this will allow you to get images that are 1:1. Now, when I say 1:1, I'm saying that if you're taking a picture of a penny, you would be so close to the penny that on your sensor, the projected image would be the full size as the one you're looking at in front of your camera. So a penny on most of your cameras would go right to the top and bottom of the frame. You can get a set of these from B&H for about $63, and they are really, really good quality for that money. Here we have some other options. We see those extension tubes in the upper right. In the top middle is a macro lens, and that's usually pretty expensive. If you have a Nikon camera, you can get an old macro lens that will work, and it's just totally manual, but you can get them for, Oh, I don't know, less than $100, because that macro lens that's in the middle on the top, which is a Nikon 60mm macro lens, that's $519. It's good quality though. In the upper left are the close-up filters that I'm having you buy for this class. And this photo was taken with the close-up filters. They sold for $14, including shipping on Amazon. The quality is really great for the price. These filters just screw into a kit lens, so this is what we'll be using. Now, what size filters do you buy? Well, you look on the inside of your lens cap, and it will tell you the size of the screw mount for the lens that you're going to use it on. In this case, it's a 52 millimeter lens. And you can see that on the inside of my lens, there's some screw threads. Now, this is really the poor man's approach. It's a very fun trick. If you have a rubber lens shade, you take your camera lens off, and then you hold it up against your camera body so the rubber lens shade makes kind of a gasket for a light, tight seal, and the results are pretty impressive. You risk getting dirt into the camera, so don't use this technique at the beach, but you get some extremely high magnification shots. So, my favorite combination for if you're shooting on a budget are these two inexpensive items: a plastic jug, which I cut out the top and then cut the bottom out completely, and I just hold that up to my lens, and then those set of close-up filters. And when you're outside in bright sunlight, you just put that subject right in the shadow of your plastic jug, and it will soften the light. It works really great. Now, these inexpensive close-up filters work on any lens that has a threaded ring for filters. So that means that they'll work, of course, on your kit lens. But if you have a telephoto lens, I would recommend that you get another set that fits on your telephoto lens, like a 70 to 200 millimeter lens. This picture was taken with a 200 millimeter lens and a plus two close-up filter. It was at about a 7 foot distance, and it's just the right distance for bird shots and poisonous snakes. Really, look how soft the background is. These close-up filters will really limit your depth of field, and that can be terrific for when you're doing bird shots. So the exposure settings for macro photography are pretty much the same for any photography if you're using those close-up filters, because those don't steal any light. They don't use any more light than a regular UV filter. The extension tubes cut light down a lot, but these close-up filters are fine. So I typically start at about ISO 800 to 1600, and I choose a fast shutter speed, about a thousandth of a second. So if I'm shooting outside, I'm shooting at f8 or f11. Now let's talk about depth of field with macro. It's really short. So in the top photo, I have shot at a 250th of a second at f16, and it looked sharp on my LCD, but when I looked at it on my computer, it was really fuzzy from camera shake. So a 250th of a second is really not fast enough to shoot extreme macro close-ups. And so when you speed up the shutter, you have to open the aperture, so you're going to have even less depth of field. The one on the top is a 250th at f16, and it's not sharp. The one on the bottom is a thousandth at f5.6, and it has less depth of field, but no blur from camera movement. So always choose a fast shutter speed for macro shots. You'll always be happier because it will just give you a lot of sharpness. I would set your mode wheel on the shutter priority, and that's the S mode for Nikon and TV mode for Canon. And you're going to have to boost up your ISO quite a bit so you can get to these fast shutter speeds. Here we have what the LCD display would look like on one of those cameras at 1600th of a second, f8 at ISO 1000. Don't be afraid to get up there to ISO 2000 or 2400. The top shot was taken with too much depth of field. It had an f-stop of f16 and a shutter speed of 250th of a second. And the background is too sharp. The bottom, you can see the bug on there, and it's got less depth of field, and it was also taken at a thousandth of a second. So we really want to go for a higher shutter speed. This is at a thousandth at f4. I moved closer to the bug, and I also cropped the image, so it helps a lot. About lighting for macro and close-up. When you get close to your subject, the first problem you'll face outdoors is that your own shadow will fall onto your subject. And that's just positively aggravating. And a shiny reflector allows you to, you know, stand to the side, avoiding a shadow. And a silver reflector will bounce about 90% of the light back into the subject. So it's going to be a well-lit shot. This collapsible reflector costs about $50. This is my solution. The best way to avoid your own shadow is to position yourself so the sun is coming from the side or from behind your subject. And this creates dramatic lighting by letting light pass through the leaves or the blossoms. And you'll need to reflect light back into the subject to fill the dark areas. And this setup always yields good results. I'm using a turkey pan that I got for $1. At the dollar store. This is what I'm seeing. Standing in front of the shade of a tree and shooting into the backlighted leaves is a good strategy. You notice that's really short depth of field, so it's not a would normally be not a very interesting shot, but the short depth of field makes it interesting. It's kind of like rim light that we talked about with portraits. I'm filling the light of the subject with the bounce reflector, and then the sun is actually coming over the top. This is also using a foil turkey pan, and it adds a little bit of sparkle to the leaves, which can be very good. So a tin foil reflector isn't good for portraiture, but it really works good for the macro setups. Keep your water bottle handy so you can put droplets onto your subject. This used to be the standard procedure for nature photographers about 30 years ago, but people seem to have forgotten this trick, but it really looks good. Now, here I am outdoors, and it's pretty bright, sunny, harsh light on that little daisy blossom. But what I'm going to recommend is using a diffuser. You can get these 42-inch diffuser reflector combination for $20, and I just balance that on my head, and you can see that it's a much improved image. So softening the light can be quite beneficial for macro, because bright sunlight without any diffusion will cause highlights on light-colored subjects and burn them up. On the lower subject of this weird plant pod, this problem is easily controlled with a plastic jug, which I mentioned earlier. So I'm just getting really, really close, and I'm putting the subject in the shadow of that plastic jug. It works really quite well. Another way to improve the lighting in the scene is by shooting through the hole in a piece of white foam core. And in this case, the reflector is resting on the lens barrel, allowing me to use two hands to control the camera. So you can tape foil on the surface of your foam core for a little bit more sparkle. But this worked really well. These subjects were backlit. In fact, while I'm shooting this photograph shown on the left, I got a shot of a bee in flight. And it's backlit with bright sunlight, but my reflector is really filling that in. Another thing that you might consider getting if you get a little more advanced is a ring flash. A ring flash is a flash attachment. It's battery operated, fits onto the front of your lens. It's not very strong, but you're so close to the subject that it works really, really well. It's a very short duration flash, and that B shot was done, and you can see that it froze the B Wing. Let's talk about some indoor macro setups for jewelry, scientific studies, and just having some fun. This is one of my favorite setups. Again, I'm using that plastic bottle and I'm shooting straight down. Lauren and I were doing a catalog for jewelry items and we just labeling these items, and I'm lifting the camera up. She slides it underneath the water bottle and I put the water bottle down and take the picture. I'm pre-focused, so everything is at the exact same distance. And if you're doing stuff for eBay or Etsy, you can get really good quality stuff. Ask me about this particular slide if you want it, and I'll send it to you as a JPEG because there's a lot more explanation. A couple of different lighting schemes that you can do at home very easily to get top quality professional results. Extremely close shots done with the setups in the previous slide produce really good quality shots. Okay, so let's start shooting a couple of practice shots and we'll wrap it up. Hello, welcome to the macro video that's going to be explaining to you some of the real easy techniques about using a macro filter. And that's what this is. Presumably you've already got the set of four of them, and I'm going to use the number four, which is pretty strong, and I'm going to put it into my camera. Now I want to mention to you that you don't want to screw these in too awful tight because they won't come out. So I've just got it screwed in enough to where it's in there, but I can remove it pretty easily. And the thing about shooting with macro is that you don't want to have to try to focus on something because it takes a lot of effort to hold the camera steady and to focus. So what I typically do is I just set the camera, get the exposure correct, and then I just move in and out until it's in focus. So for this little illustration, I've just got a coffee cup here and I'm going to put my subject on top of the coffee cup. I've got a music stand light, or reading lamp, and these are really, really handy because they just clip on and then you can use them. It's like a third hand and it helps position stuff. So let me just put that on, and it has two settings. I'm going to put it on the low setting. So let's say the very first thing we're going to do is we're just going to take a picture of this harmonica. All right, so I'm going to get over to the side here like this. I want to position this thing so the light is kind of interesting on there. All right. And the thing about having a cup or something is that it holds this item up a little bit off of the table, because you don't want to shoot down on something with macro. You kind of want to be at eye level with it. And again, I've already just set up my camera, so I'm just moving in and out to get my focus, and I'm just going to shoot it at about a 350th of a second. You know, so this really harsh light is not so good for metal objects like this. It's, it's not that great. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a diffuser on this, which is just a little piece of tissue paper. Okay, now what I've done is I've softened this light, and so it's a bigger light. And so when I look at this piece of Kleenex, you can see that it's got a bigger pattern than just a harsh light. And I'm going to look in the reflection of this metallic harmonica at that light. And it's going to give me a real nice highlight. It's going to pour a nice highlight across the front of that shiny metal harmonica. That looks so much better. Let's change the subject. I've got this little funny ceramic figure, and I'm gonna shoot a couple of little close-ups of his face first. That looks good. And change the lighting. Let's give him a hair light. So most of our shooting will be done outside in the shade, but I wanted to show you what it looks like when you're using artificial light, because it helps and you get a little more dramatic stuff. So look at the assignment sheet. It'll tell you how many shots you're supposed to turn in, and I recommend using the number 4 filter. It's kind of in the medium range and it allows you to get pretty darn close. All right, good luck.